Welcome to Brother Miller's Notes, as we study one of my all-time favorite sections, Section 76 of the Doctrine and Covenants. Now, and I just got to pause right here and just let you know. Sometimes you have topics that you really, really, really like as a teacher, and you can spend a lot of time on it. I did a recording of this section, and it was over 45 minutes long. And I thought, you know, I have a lot of questions that I ask in here, and I did a lot of quotes. I thought, you know, I got to pick up the pace. So it's still going to be a long one. Just so you're here, if you're watching this, listening to this, you got to be prepared for that. But I did pick up the pace. I'll have a lot more quotes on my website that refer to these things. But just so you know, I will ask some questions and likely not answer them. Or I may answer them and just it may just end up being another 45 minutes. So this may be one that you'll want to pause. Because one of the things that in this section, there's so much to cover, and you think, do I really understand it? And I found that when you can explain something so simply and clearly that you can't misunderstand it, that you understand it as a teacher. Like, for example, how do you simply explain who's going to the celestial, terrestrial, or telestial section, or telestial kingdoms? Section 76 does this. It gives an expanded thing, but there's a couple verses that say very simply, one little line, here's who goes there. That's one of the things I love about Section 76, is it has a lot of depth, but it's simple and beautiful. So just as a reminder, they're in the John Johnson home, and Joseph and Sydney are there, and they're working on an inspired translation of the Bible. And as they're working on the inspired translation of the Bible, they come to John chapter 5, verse 29, which says, "And shall come forth they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation." And they start to really kind of think about this, and I like the changes that are made in the Joseph Smith translation. "And shall come forth they who," I like that they're a who and not a that, "have done good in the resurrection instead of life, the just," because a resurrection is a renewal of life. You're brought back to a perfect body with different glories, whether you're celestial, terrestrial, or telestial. So it is, all of it is life. But, so there's two resurrections, the just and they who have done evil in the resurrection of the unjust. And as they see this vision, it's not just Joseph and Sidney in the room. Now, Joseph and Sidney are the only ones seeing the vision, but there are other people who are there, and there are people who are coming and going. They're just being there quiet. They see the power of the vision. They feel the spirit. They feel a power as the vision's happening. But Joseph and Sidney are describing it to each other. Philo Dibble said this. Here's how his description. Joseph would say at intervals, "What do I see?" As one might say while looking out the window and beholding what was in the room he couldn't see. Then he relayed what he had seen or what he was looking at. Then Sidney replied, "I see the same." Presently, Sidney would say, "What do I see?" and repeat what he had seen or was seeing. And Joseph would reply, "I see the same." This manner of conversation was repeated at short intervals to the end of the vision. And during the whole time, not a word was spoken by any other person. Not a sound nor motion was made by anyone but Joseph or Sidney. And it seemed to me that they never moved a joint or limb during the time I was there, which I think was over an hour. To the end of the vision, Joseph sat firmly and calmly all the time in the midst of a magnificent glory, but Sidney sat limp and pale, apparently as limber as a rag. Observing which, Joseph remarked smilingly, "Sidney's not as used to it as I am." The vision as recorded is 1/100th of what they saw. I'll tell you, I'd love to get the other 99% of what they saw and all the rich details that they'd add. Section 76 can be divided into six separate visions. A vision of the glory of the Father and the Son. There is the fall of Lucifer and the sons of perdition. Then you have a vision of celestial glory, terrestrial glory, and telestial glory. And as I started my study, I started thinking, why start with a vision of the Savior? And I think I got that in my mind. Why? I mean, that's the hope. That's how we are able to have hope for the future, hope for resurrection, hope to be with God again. But then why go to a vision of Satan right after that? And then back to vision of celestial glory. Because for me, it kind of makes sense to say Savior, then celestial glory, then terrestrial, then telestial, then sons of perdition and Satan. But I think there's reason for that. And so my study of the section 76 really is all about questions. And maybe before you start yours, or as maybe you study with a family or in a group, you may just say, hey, write down any question you have about the resurrection or judgment or a celestial kingdom or terrestrial kingdom or telestial kingdom or out of darkness. And maybe, you know, you could do like a handout or something where you say, okay, I'm going to divide you into groups. You know, as I'm teaching a class, I want you to study about Christ, which is always going to be good. What do you see? Or what was seen there? What stands out to you? And what questions you have? Write them down. Another group's doing Satan. Another one's doing sons of perdition. One other one's doing celestial or terrestrial or terrestrial. And then really that's kind of a little bit of the lesson is you've been studying it. What questions do you have? And there's other people in the class likely, like if you're in gospel doctrine, they probably know the answer. You have pretty bright people in every ward. And going into this vision, you think about what the world's concept is of heaven and hell. When Joseph and Sidney, before they have this vision, what do people think that heaven looks like or hell looks like? Now, for me, one of the best ways to describe that type worldview is through Farside. If you've ever seen Farside, boy, you've had a treat. But I love the comic strip. So this one is Farside. Hey, 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 who's the wise guy that just turned down the thermostat? I can just picture Satan or little minions doing that. And maybe up in the celestial kingdom, according to Farside, they've got a shotgun, and you're not supposed to be doing that, Mitch. Back down, kind of a comparison, because you think, what kind of music is in heaven? What kind of music's in hell? Well, here's your harp. Great, that you're welcome to heaven. And when you're in hell, welcome to hell. Here's your accordion. Now, if you're an accordion player, didn't mean to offend you on that one. And I can imagine there being a suggestion box in hell. And the devil and his minions' reactions as they read the suggestions in the suggestion box. Can you imagine Colonel Sanders entering the pearly gates if there are chickens on both sides? Okay, and you have the people who just, there you are in the hell, happy, just enjoying it, and one devil saying to the other, you know, we're just not reaching that guy. Well, that's the worldview that Joseph comes into. And then we get section 76. And the first thing is characteristics of Jesus Christ. And I love what's mentioned there. And for me, verse 1, as I read it, that idea that hear and rejoice, because that is section 76. It builds you up as you study it. You may be thinking, what is it that Christ mentions in those first five verses that's meaningful to you? And why? How does that build you up? And I love what the Lord does right up front. My purpose, my sacrifice is intended to help you become more like me and live back with my heavenly Father. So he gives you promises. Here's promises to those who serve the Lord. So verse 6, you're going to have glory. And I'm going to reveal all the mysteries to you, all the hidden ones. I'm going to give you everything concerning my kingdom. And I'm going to make sure you know the wonders of eternity. You're going to know it and you understand it. And I'm going to show it to you. And your wisdom is going to be great. And you're not only going to be know it, but you're going to understand it. It's going to reach to heaven. The Spirit is going to enlighten. It's going to uplift. It's going to build you up. And I'm going to tell you all my secrets. And I love that he just says, even those things that eye has not seen, nor ears heard, nor has yet entered into the heart of man. And I would encourage people just underline those promises out of anything in section 76. Underline the promises God has made to you. And you know, just think about what Joseph and Sidney did that led to their vision. Well, they enumerate it in section 76. Here's our comments. We had the Spirit with us. We were in the Spirit. We're in the middle of the work of translation. So maybe it's your personal Scripture study. And sometimes maybe it is work as you're studying. It's not just reading, it's studying. You have the Spirit with you. You're working at it with the Scriptures because reading Revelation invites revelation, especially when you stop and take time, like verse 18, to marvel and meditate. You ponder on it. Well, you may be thinking, all that it led to their eyes being understood and opened. But that's also a promise for us today. We can do things that help us understand the scriptures and have these type of experiences as well, where our eyes are opened, our understanding is opened. Modern day apostles and prophets have encouraged us to do this. I love this quote. When I say study, I mean something more than reading. I see you sometimes reading a few verses, stopping to ponder them, carefully reading the verses again, and as you think about what they mean, praying for understanding, asking questions in your mind, waiting for spiritual impressions, and writing down the impressions and insights that come so you can remember and learn more. Studying in this way, you may not read a lot of chapters or verses in a half hour, but you'll be giving place in your hearts for the Word of God, and He will be speaking to you. And remember what our prophet has been encouraging us to do with his first public discourse. He encouraged us to pray. Take the prophet Joseph Smith's example. Pray. Listen to what the Lord has to say. Write down the things that come to your mind. Record those in spiritual impressions and act on it. Especially as you study the plan of salvation. And for me, with that introduction of the Savior and how He describes Him and those promises, it reminds me that this whole plan that we're going to talk about really is centered around the love that God has for us. It is. Love is the grand motive of the plan of salvation. And so the rest of my video, I'm just going to ask some questions and maybe give answers. And maybe you already know all the answers as soon as I ask the question. But that's my game plan here. The vision in verses 20 to 24 of Christ, you think, okay, why is He on the right hand of God? What does it mean to receive the fullness of the Father and the Son? What does sanctified mean? Are there people today who've truly seen the Savior? What does only begotten mean? Who creates worlds? It's not world. It is worlds plural three times in this section. It's mentioned that Christ creates world, and all the inhabitants that are on these worlds are under the power of His atonement. His atonement covers the inhabitants of all the worlds that He has created. How vital is the atonement of Christ? How do we become begotten sons and daughters of God? So just thinking, what does it mean to receive the fullness of the Father and the Son? To receive that fullness that the Savior offered is accept Him as the one who made that salvation possible. It's through His atonement. We got to follow His teachings. So kind of a summary, to experience the fullness of joy requires one to keep the commandments of God. And sanctified is a word that most people know, but it's great just to talk about what it means. To be sanctified, it's to be saved. To fall short of sanctification is to fail to gain full salvation. Only the sanctified gain eternal life. To be sanctified is to be clean. It is a state of purity and spotlessness which no taint of sin is found. It consists of those laws, doctrine, ordinances, powers, and authorities needed to enable men to gain fullness of salvation. And how do we become the sons and daughters of God? When this true faith takes root in a person, it inevitably leads to repentance. To be complete, however, repentance requires a covenant of obedience. This is the covenant expressed by Benjamin's people to do God's will and to be obedient to His commandments. As we reflect on these examples and other scriptures, it becomes clear that spiritual rebirth originates with faith in Jesus Christ, by whose grace we are changed. More specifically, it's faith in Christ as the atoning one, the Redeemer, who can cleanse from sin and make holy. And Elder Christofferson concludes, thus, having relied upon the merits of Him who is mighty to save, we are quickened in the inner man, and if not fully born again, then certainly well into the path of spiritual rebirth. That's how we become sons and daughters, begotten sons and daughters of God. Now verses 25 to 29 is a vision of Satan. And just thinking, I mean, other than that little video, if you're seeing it, looks kind of creepy. What authority does Satan have? Can you sin in premortal life? How can you be in the presence of God and just not get it? What does it mean to be thrust down? Thrust down where? Define perdition or Lucifer. What does it mean to say he was, past tense Lucifer? What does it mean to be a son of the morning? Define Satan. What was his intent? What was this all about for Satan? Well, you think about what authority Satan had. President George Q. Cannon said, some have called him the son of the morning, but here it is, a son of the morning, one among many, doubtless, a son of the morning. Okay, this angel was a mighty personage without doubt. The record is given to us concerning him clearly shows that he occupied a very high position. He was thought of a great deal of, and that he was mighty in his sphere. Mighty enough that when he falls, the heavens, that would have been you and I, wept for him. Can you sin in premortal life? The answer is, yeah. Another special son, brilliant. The scriptures call him an authority in the presence of God. But lacking love except for self, disdained the Father's plan and rebelled against it. He had strong opinions of his own, and he contrived some rules of his own. Seemed to feel his Father's way inefficient and imperfect. He rebelled and misled and led away a multitude of his Father's children. Now, these words are wonderful to define and teach you a lot. I wrote these definitions down in my scriptures. The Lucifer's name means light bearer or shining one. It's what he was. Perdition means loss or destruction. It's what he became. He became loss or destruction. Lucifer fell from his position as a glorious being to a position of utter loss or destruction. The name Satan means adversity, adversary, or one who withstands, an opponent, one who really is there to attack. What was Satan's intent? I mean, I just try and think, what's your end game? Why are you doing all this? Elder Critchlow explained it this way. Lucifer's strategy is to induce the cast, like in a play, to use their individual agency in a way that will produce chaos on the stage. By exposing the cast to as much evil as possible, he hopes to gain numerical strength so that he might shout when the curtains roll down at the end of the play, I have the majority of the heavenly host on my side. Numerical strength is my power. Now I can claim thine honor. Now I will ascend into heaven. Now exalt my throne above the stars of heaven. Hey, get the vision of the sons of perdition. And you think, what does it mean to know the power of God? How do you become a partaker of his promise? What is to deny and defy? Are sons of perdition only boys? Does that mean that it would be better for them to never have been born? Why is there no forgiveness of the sons of perdition? Does the atonement of Christ not work? How do you deny the Spirit? What exactly is the second death? And why will God not save them? And what is outer darkness really like? Are sons of perdition ordained or preordained or destined outer darkness? All great questions. And I'm going to pause right here. There is a temptation sometimes to spend a lot of time on the sons of perdition. I think I've got like 5 quotes coming up. And if you're in a class, I would make sure you manage your time that this isn't the focus, because really the focus is Christ and how Christ is enabling us and assisting us through his atonement, his sacrifice, to be able to live with God again. That's where he wants us. And so I just give that to you. I went into a class one time and almost the entire section 76, the whole last sentence, so it was 88 minutes, was on the sons of perdition. At the very end, there was a summary of Christ, the summary of the celestial kingdom, and the other, and it was done, and that was all section 76. And so just keep that in mind. Okay, what does it mean to know the power of God? Unto the Holy Ghost has been given to the right of the privilege of manifesting truth unto men as no other power will. So that when he makes a man see and know things, he knows it better than he shall ever know anything else. And to sin against that knowledge is to sin against the greatest light there is, and consequently commit the greater sin that there is. What does it mean to know the power of God? See, I love this. This is probably my favorite quote by the prophet Joseph Smith on this topic. Because he uses an analogy of just think about being in the sun in July. You're outside, it's cloudless, it's like 90, 100 degrees, lots of humidity. You feel the sun's effect on you. You can see the light. You know, you feel the warmth on your head and on your shoulders. And then you look at the sun and kind of talk to your friend and say, I don't see the sun. It's not out right now. You know the gospel that well, knowing it and denying it. In the prophet Joseph Smith's words, what must a man do to commit the unpardonable sin? He must receive the Holy Ghost, have the heavens open unto him, and know God, and then sin against him. After a man has sinned against the Holy Ghost, there is no repentance for him. He's got to say that the sun does not shine while he sees it. He's got to deny Christ when the heavens have been opened unto him and deny the plan of salvation with his eyes open to the truth of it. And from that time, he begins to be an enemy. This is the case with many apostates from the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. President Spencer W. Kimball maybe helped us understand that last part of the quote a little bit better. He said, the sin against the Holy Ghost requires such knowledge that is manifestly impossible for the rank and file to commit such a sin. We just haven't had the heavens opened unto us that much. Are Sons of Perdition only boys? I love this reply from Elder Bruce R. McConkie. Somebody called me up on the telephone and asked me if there were daughters of perdition. I said, I don't know. And he said, how can I find out? I just called Spencer Kimball. He told me he didn't know either. Spencer B. Kimball the prophet, and Elder Bruce R. McConkie, one of the great scriptorians of our dispensation. At any rate, we don't know. I'm sure there may be somebody who wants to tell you they know. Don't pay attention to them. Why is there no forgiveness for Sons of Perdition? I think in short, it's because they don't have the ability to repent. Orson Whitney explained it this way. Their sin is an offense so heinous that the sinner is unable to repent. And this is what makes his case hopeless. If he could repent, he could be forgiven. But being capable of repentance, he cannot be reached by the pardoning power. So how do you deny the Holy Ghost Spirit? To commit some pardonable crime, a man must receive the gospel, gain from the Holy Ghost revelation the absolute knowledge of the divinity of Christ, and then deny the new and everlasting covenant by which he was sanctified, calling it an unholy thing, doing despite the grace, the Spirit of grace. He thereby commits murder, assenting unto the Lord's death. That is, having perfect knowledge of truth, comes out in open rebellion, and places himself in a position where he would have crucified Christ, knowing perfectly the while he was the Son of God. Christ is thus crucified afresh and put in open shame. In other words, you know the gospel, you know you've had those covenants, and then if you were there, you would have been one of those that would be crucifying Christ. What exactly is the second death? Spiritual death is to be cast out of the presence of the Lord, to die to things of righteousness, to die to the things of the Spirit. Spirit beings, as such, never die in the sense of annihilation or in the sense that the spirit bodies are disorganized. Rather, they continue to live to all eternity, either as spirits or as resurrected personages. Eventually, all are redeemed from spiritual death, except those who have sinned unto death. That is, those who are destined to be sons of perdition. This is the second death. And thus the Lord said in our day that the sons of perdition are the only ones whom the second death shall have power, meaning any power after the resurrection. So, what's outer darkness really like? Well, you can read it. Only those who have had it, who are going to experience it, they've had it opened up to them. Well, there you go. But I will note one thing on brimstone. It's that lava, maybe a little acidic part. Sulfuric acid that would, not only after the lava type would burn into your skin, it would also eat away after it's cool. Joseph Smith taught, a man is his own tormentor and his own condemner. Hence the saying, they shall go into the lake that burns with fire and brimstone. The torment and disappointment in the mind of man is as exquisite as a lake burning with fire and brimstone. I say, so is the torment of man. Are the sons of perdition predestined or ordained to outer darkness? No, they're not foreordained. In the sense of pre-elected by God to condemnation. God has ordained that rebellion against him shall result, if persisted into the end, in misery. But he's not foreordained anyone to that fate. The sons of perdition produce their course according to their own choice, not as victims of inexorable destiny. All right, we'll move on to happier things. Celestial kingdom. What is the resurrection of the just? Are there more than one resurrection? How does one truly receive a testimony? And what does it mean to make and keep baptismal covenants? We are told to receive the Holy Ghost. How do we do that? What does it mean to overcome by faith? Overcome what? What's the spirit of promise? What is the church of the firstborn? Is it different than the church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints? What things does the Father give? And what does that entail? And probably the number one question I'm asked by students, how many people are really going to make the celestial kingdom? I mean, really make it. Okay, well, I'm going to answer that one out of these 10. Okay, resurrection of the just. Is there more than one resurrection? Yes. In modern revelation, given to the church, the Lord has made known in more revelation this glorious event. There shall be at least two classes which shall have the privilege of resurrection at this time, or the resurrection of the just. First, those who dwell in the presence of God and his Christ forever and ever. And second, honorable men, those who belong to the terrestrial kingdom as well as those in the celestial kingdom. I often pause at this time to talk about the morning of the first resurrection and just kind of help students see the morning of the first resurrection started with the resurrection of Jesus Christ and extends into the first part of the millennium. And then I just talk about how those who have been faithful will be resurrected either if they haven't been resurrected already, and that's a smaller number of people, they'll be resurrected at the second coming of Christ, or into the first part of if they're still living, in the first part of the millennium. That's the morning of the first resurrection. Because there's quite a few who may have that phrase in their patriarchal blessings, and may want to know that if they're true to what their patriarchal blessing has promised, if they're true to their covenant, they're being promised that they'll be resurrected to celestial glory in the morning, the first part of the first resurrection of the just. What is the Holy Spirit of promise? Thus, an act of the seal by the Holy Spirit of promise is one that is ratified by the Holy Ghost. It's one that is approved by the Lord. And the person who is taking the obligation upon himself is justified by the Spirit in the thing that he has done. The ratifying seal of approval is put upon an act only if those entering the contract are worthy as a result of personal righteousness to receive the divine approbation. What is a church of the firstborn? Let me just give you a short answer. It's a church within a church. It is a members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints become members of the Church of the Firstborn. I know it may surprise you, but it doesn't appear that everybody who becomes a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints will be a celestial being. The gospel casts a wide net, maybe like the parable of the virgins. You have some who are ready for Christ when he comes and some don't. Here's the way President Joseph Fielding Smith talked about who the Church of the Firstborn is. Those who gain exaltation in the celestial kingdom are those who are members of the Church of the Firstborn. In other words, who keep all the commandments of the Lord. The Lord has made it possible for us to become members of the Church of the Firstborn by receiving the blessings of the house of the Lord and overcoming all things. Thus we become heirs, priests, and kings who have received his fullness and his glory, who should dwell in the presence of God and his Christ forever and ever with full exaltation. Now, I'm often asked how many people will make it celestial kingdom. There's this idea that it's only going to be a handful. And that is not what the scriptures teach. Section 76, verse 67, talks about those in the celestial kingdom are an innumerable company. You can't count them. Revelation chapter 7, it's a great multitude that are there in with God, which no man could number. Section 107 refers to those celestial kingdom as a multitude of nations. Daniel in the Old Testament refers to it as thousand thousands, which is kind of a Hebrewism that really is symbolic of infinite. He can't count them. Section 138, innumerable companies of the Spirit of the Just are waiting for Christ to come into the spirit world to teach them. And Hebrews 12, number 6, is an innumerable company. Are in the heavenly Jerusalem with God. And section 137 teaches those who die before the age of 8 are heirs of the celestial kingdom. And those who die without knowing a knowledge of the gospel and later receive it are also can be heirs of the celestial kingdom. Like Hiram is an example, Hiram Smith, Joseph's brother. And just think about the number of kids who have died before the age of 8. The mortality rate of children over the last two millennia is the number of infants that have died in the first year is about 25% over the last millennia. So one out of four children over the last couple millennia have died before their first year, first birthday. And you have about half of the children who have died before they reach the end of puberty or adulthood. So if they estimate 117 billion have been born on this earth, that's the surviving. And you think, well, half of those survived to adulthood. So you're thinking, around 60 billion people died before they were adults. And so an estimate that they have of the mortality rate is like 42.2 around the age of 8, die before their age of 8. That's a lot of people who are heirs of the celestial kingdom because they died before the age of accountability. Now, section 76, talking about the celestial kingdom. A couple more questions. Is the Melchizedek priesthood necessary for a celestial kingdom? What does it mean that they are gods? And define subdue. Why will we reign on earth? Won't we be in the celestial kingdom? Where in heaven are the names of celestial kingdom people in the celestial kingdom written? Well, why are we going to reign on earth? I'll tackle that question just for a minute, because the earth will be renewed and receive its paradisical glory, and it will become the earth's destiny. is to be a celestial place. That's what the prophets have taught us. Joseph Fielding Smith taught, this new heaven and earth, which will come into existence when our Lord comes to reign, is the same earth with its heavens renewed and restored to its primitive condition and beauty. Everything is to be brought back nearly as possible to its position as it was in the beginning. The mountains, we are informed, will be thrown down, the valleys will be exalted, and the earth shall be like it was in days before it was divided. So a few more questions about celestial kingdom. Do I have to be perfect to make it to the celestial kingdom? What's the celestial body like? What does it mean that they are seen as they are seen and know as they are known? What does equal in power mean? Well, won't you get bored in the celestial kingdom? You know, you got being there forever. Well, a couple answers to some of those questions. Do I have to be perfect to make a celestial kingdom? The answer is, the scriptures teach we become perfect through Christ, in Christ. Without him, not a chance. Or, we become perfect eventually through Christ. President Ezra F. Benson taught, those who are just and true. What an apt expression for those who are valiant in the testimony of Jesus. They are courageous in defending truth and righteousness. They are members of the church who magnify their calling in the church. They pay their tithes, their offerings, live morally clean lives. They sustain their church leaders by word and action, keep the Sabbath as a holy day, and obey all the commandments of God. To these the Lord has promised that all thrones and dominions, principalities and powers shall be revealed and set forth upon all who have endured valiantly for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, talking like with the terrestrial kingdom, is there a difference between a celestial person and a terrestrial person between their bodies? What does it mean if they died without laws? If these people receive testimony of Jesus in the spirit prison, why can they not obtain a celestial glory? Because sometimes that's a little tricky for some. What does an honorable man look like? Are they not celestial? What does receive his glory but not of his fullness mean? All right. President Joseph Fielding Smith answers this question. If these people receive testimony of Jesus in the spirit prison, why can they not obtain a celestial glory? He says, into the terrestrial kingdom will go all those who are honorable, who live clean, virtuous lives, but who would not receive the gospel, but in the spirit world repented and accepted it as far as it would be given unto them. Many of these have been blinded by tradition and the love of the world and have not been able to see the beauties of the gospel. Oh, a couple more questions. Will terrestrial people be in the presence of the sun? What does a terrestrial body look like? What does valiant mean? How does not being valiant assign these people to this kingdom? What do people in the terrestrial kingdom do forever? Well, here's what valiant means. It is to be courageous and bold. It's to use our strength, our energy, our ability in the warfare with the world to fight the good fight of faith. The great cornerstone of valiance in the cause of righteousness is obedience to the whole law of the whole gospel. Bruce R. McConkie explained it this way. To be valiant in the testimony of Jesus is to come to Christ, be perfected in him, is to deny ourselves of all ungodliness, and to love God with all our might, mind, and strength. To be valiant in the testimony of Jesus is to believe in Christ and his testimony with unshakable conviction. It is to know with the verity and divinity of the Lord's work on earth. To me, being valiant is trying every day to do your best. That's it. You do your best, and you're not perfect, but you just keep trying. And you stand as a witness at all times and all things and all places that Jesus is the Christ. All right, telestial. Why wouldn't someone accept the gospel if it was presented to them in the spirit world? I mean, you think about it. Here's the gospel. Here's the kingdoms. It's kind of a no-brainer. Why don't I just accept it? Of course, I think that sometimes with people today. Why don't you just accept it? What does it mean that these people are thrust down to hell? When is the last resurrection? Will these people be taught by the Holy Spirit? Is the telestial kingdom better than earth? Is there more than one division or degree in the telestial kingdom? Why are liars grouped with these people? I mean, there's some pretty serious sins there. Why liars? What does it mean to bow and confess to God? Won't they then accept the gospel? What do people in the telestial kingdom do forever? Well, is the kingdom, telestial kingdom better than earth? Elder Johnny Witzel explained, the Doctrine and Covenant explains clearly that the lowest glory to which man is assigned is so glorious as to be beyond the understanding of man. It is doctrine fundamental in Mormonism that the meanest sinner in the final judgment will receive a glory which is beyond human understanding, which is so great that we're able to describe it adequately. We're not able to describe it adequately. Unable. There we go. Unable to describe it adequately. Those who do well will receive an even more glorious place. So is there more than one division or degree in the celestial or telestial kingdom? Three kingdoms, widely differing glories, are organized on an ordinary plan of gradation. We have seen that in the telestial kingdom comprises several subdivisions. This is also the case, we are told, with the celestial. And, by analogy, we conclude that a similar condition prevails in the terrestrial. Thus, the innumerable degrees of merit among mankind are provided for an infinity of graded glories. So you get this vision, and what was the reaction? I mean, we read this vision, and we go, yes, this is awesome. Well, what did the saints think about it when it was first given? A lot of them struggled with this vision. You get faithful people like Brigham Young who say, my traditions were such that when the vision came to me, it was so directly contrary and opposed to my former education. I said, wait a little. I did not reject it, but I could not understand it. There was not acceptance there. I'm not going to reject it. But man, right up front, it's not like, yeah, this is awesome. Joseph Young said, I could not believe it at first. Why the Lord was going to save everybody. Once again, you had this thought that, you know, there's only a few going to heaven, and you got those people going to hell, and it's 50-50. I don't know about the exact percentages, but to have everybody have a kingdom of glory was a struggle for people to receive, except for the sons of perdition. This is one of the greatest revelations we've ever received. And I love the way Elder Melvin J. Ballard summarized it. The greatest revelation the Lord, Jesus Christ, has ever made to man, so far as record is made, was given to the prophet Joseph Smith, known as the 76th section of the Book of Doctrine and Covenants, commonly called, for years, and is still known as the Vision. I say, this to my mind is the climax of all wonderful revelations that have come from the Lord from the days of Father Adam until the present moment. And just kind of last thing or two. You may be aware that there was a poetic version written by Joseph Smith of section 76. Because for him, remember, he only gives us 1/100th of this. And so he writes it in a poem. Now, he's working with W.W. Phelps. And a lot of this sounds like W.W. Phelps. It is published in Nauvoo in 1843. And Joseph has the approval. But the kind of the poetry is a kind of a combination of Joseph and W.W. Phelps. But it's Joseph who takes, he's wrote this. And like in verse 11, this, I, Joseph the prophet, in spirit beheld, and the eyes of the inner man truly did see, eternity sketched in a vision from God, of what was, and now is, and yet is to be. It really is quite pretty poetry. And it adds a little more detail and a little more clarification of what you've read in section 76. So, Dr. Lawrence Flake, in his book 3 Degrees of Glory, he puts them side by side, and you can kind of see what it's talking about. I have there's a link to a PDF right there, and I'll have it in my notes where you can read it. I would highly recommend reading both side by side as in your study this year of section 76. Now, going back to the original question, how can you explain everything we just said about the three kingdoms simply and directly? Who goes to the celestial? Who goes to the terrestrial? Who goes to the telestial kingdom? As simply as possible. Because sometimes we get a little bit mixed up. I know I do. Section 76 does it. I love the way it says in verse 82 about the telestial. It's very simply, they receive not the gospel, neither the testimony of Jesus. So not going to make covenants, not going to accept what's being taught, and I'm not going to even admit Jesus is the Christ right here and now. Okay? That's telestial. Now later, they do accept Jesus is the Christ. Every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess he is the Christ. But they receive not the gospel, neither testimony of Jesus Christ. Celestial, and I'm jumping a little bit, but there's a thing. They have received the testimony of Jesus Christ. That's verse 51. Then list some things of the gospel. Faith, repentance, baptism, gift of the Holy Ghost. Principles and ordinances of the gospel. So it really is simply they received the testimony of Jesus and they accepted the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then for that middle kingdom, it seems they received the testimony of Jesus in this life or in the spirit world, but they don't really accept the gospel. They're honorable, but not willing to make that covenant and commitment to Christ. So that's kind of the way I see it as simply, and that's kind of the way the Doctrine and Covenants outlines simply who goes to which kingdoms. Now, just my last little teaching thoughts. Before you begin your study, write down your questions that you have about the spirit world, judgment, resurrection, kingdoms of glory, and look for the answers in section 76. And I found that reading Revelation invites revelation as we ponder on it. May the Lord bless you to be able to find the answers to your questions. And then as you kind of go through this, be thinking, where do you see yourself in this vision? Where do you see yourself in the plan of happiness? If you were to draw the plan of happiness, where would you draw you in it? And, you know, I don't know who's watching this, but my guess is, if you are watching it, you're studying the scriptures. You're doing the best you can. I fully expect one day that we'll have a little reunion. We'll do the Study My Gospel reunion in the celestial kingdom. Because I think God is doing everything he can in his power to help us be there. And I trust him. And then you may be thinking, okay, where does Christ see you in that plan? And where does he want to be? Maybe you look at your patriarchal blessing. What glimpses does it give you there? And phrases like morning of the first resurrection. And you know, as you study it, I love that idea in classes or bigger groups. You break it up into six visions and have groups study each vision. And you know, then it's not what I learn. It's, will you teach what everybody you think they should know about this little mini vision that will help them in their lives today? Well, thanks so much for spending a little bit of time with me. I know this is a little bit of a long one. It's probably my longest one ever. I appreciate it. And then I'll add one other thing. I did hear from Cedar Fort that the editors are working on my book right now. And for me, that's just exciting. It's to be published in November 2021. Apparently, it's going to be a two-volume set. So we'll see. I think that those editors will actually make me sound good. I'm looking forward to that. Hey, thanks. Have a lovely day. Keep smiling.